260 million tons of food grains, over 260 million tons of fruits and vegetables, and 140 million tons of milk. We are the largest producer of milk in the world. All of them have come from what we call technology of production by masses. Production by masses means our country, very large number, over 60% of our population of 120 crore, they are in agriculture. They depend on agriculture for the livelihood. This is very different. In the US, it's hardly 2%. 2% of people are engaged in agriculture. So ours is a technology of production by masses. It is not a mass production technology. That is why the family farm becomes exceedingly important, and you have to work very hard to fulfill this obligation. We can't relax. In spite of, I mentioned 260 million tons of food grains, 260 million tons of fruits and vegetables, 140 million tons of milk. In spite of all these very impressive production figures, we find that very large number of people, children, women and men, go to bed hungry in our country. There is high prevalence of endemic hunger. There is large amount of anemia among pregnant women. Every fourth child born is low birth weight baby, less than 2.5 kg in weight. It has its own difficulties and so on. Therefore, we can't, what is the use of producing more if people cannot have access to the food? This is where the Food Security Act will be of help. There are three kinds of hunger. If you are going to become hunger fighters, you all got medals and so on. Medals are important, but the greatest medal you will get is satisfaction from having transferred your knowledge to the people who need it and trying to increase production. There are three kinds of hunger. One is endemic hunger or undernutrition, largely caused by poverty, lack of purchasing power. This is what the Food Security Act addresses, those who cannot purchase hardly 1 rupee per kilogram of millets, two rupees for wheat, and 3 rupees per kilogram of rice. So the calorie deprivation in our country, if we implement the Food Security Act properly, can be achieved. But then there are two other forms of hunger. Protein hunger, the deficiency of proteins in the diet. I know Vidarbha grows a large amount of pulses, various kinds of pulses. Pulses are a very important source of proteins. Unfortunately, we are still deficient in pulses. About 4 million tons of pulses we import from outside. And that is why it is important all of you, those who are working here, should improve the production of pulses. 2 years from now, has been declared by the United Nations as the International Year of Pulses. It's called the International Year of Pulses. I hope you will intensify your work and also spread them. The third kinds of hunger, I said, endemic hunger, undernutrition, calorie deprivation, protein hunger. The third kind of hunger is called hidden hunger. Hidden hunger is very serious because you don't diagnose it. Vitamin A deficiency in the young child causes blindness. The vitamin A deficiency causes blindness. And also iron deficiency, anemia, is very common among pregnant women. Iodine, iron, zinc, and most of the vitamin A, vitamin B12. So those who are going to use your knowledge to help the country, not only to eradicate hunger, because the United Nations last year at Rio de Janeiro launched what is called a zero hunger program. A zero hunger means no hunger at all. And all the governments, including our own government, said that by 2025, in another 11 years, we should have zero hunger challenge. The zero hunger challenge, what are its components? If you want to work on the zero hunger challenge, you can work in any of these areas. First, 100% access to adequate food all the year round. Throughout the year, there must be food access. In a drought year and a flood year, it does. Zero stunted children below 2 years. Stunting caused by malnutrition, zero stunted children. All food systems must be sustainable. In fact, the UN Millennium Development Goals, which come to an end next year, 2015, will be redesignated as the UN Sustainable Development Goals. Sustainable Development Goals. So everything which you do must be environmentally sustainable. What I have called many times, evergreen revolution. From the green revolution to the evergreen revolution. That is improvement of productivity in perpetuity without ecological harm. Then there is 100% increase in smallholder productivity. And finally, very important, is zero or no loss or waste of food. Of course, in our country, food losses happen at mostly at the production stage, not so much at the post-harvest stage. In the developed countries, rich countries, a lot of food waste is at the other end. That is during consumption phase, not during production phase, but consumption phase. So enlargement of the food basket, we have now added more grains and so on. And therefore, there is a possibility today of providing agricultural remedies to nutritional maladies. Identify in your own village or in your own place, what are the nutritional problems? Is it undernutrition? Is it protein hunger? Protein hunger, immediately you can see the children on the streets. The street children usually have a blonde hair. The blonde hair is a good indication of lack of protein in the diet. Therefore, you identify what the problems are and apply the appropriate remedies to the problem. I find here in the audience, there are people who are working in what is called biofortification. Biofortification means you add nutrients to the crop. For example, biofortified bajra, iron-rich bajra is now available. Mr. Ashish Velle, who is with the Nirmal Seeds, is here. You will ask him, how did you produce this iron-rich bajra? There are zinc-rich wheat, vitamin A-rich sweet potato, and so on. Therefore, in the last year's central budget, those of you, all our agricultural people, should read at least the agricultural portion of the budget to see what kind of provisions are being made. Last year, the finance minister introduced about 250 crore for our agriculture universities to take up new tree farms. New tree farms means, according to the requirement of that area, vitamin A, vitamin B12, you introduce those crops. So now there is no time to relax, because just now, as I said, we have gone into a legal commitment. Agriculture for the first time has entered into a legal commitment to provide food. We need, if you read my paper, you'll find I have classified what you need to do into three groups of issues. One is defend the gains already made. We have made some gains, we must defend them, because the climate change is there, loss of land is there, new pests and diseases coming. Therefore, there is no time to relax on the food production front. Eternal vigilance is the price of stable agriculture. That means you have to have a three-pronged strategy: defend the gains already made, extend the gains to new areas like dry farming areas without irrigation and so on, and then finally make new gains at the post-harvest level everywhere. Now, in all these areas, for the farmers are concerned, assured and remunerative marketing is the most important. I'm happy I met some of you who are working on the marketing side. When farmers have worked very hard in sun and rain and produce grains for you and me, unless they get a good price, they will be disappointed. So assured and remunerative marketing, then if you are interested what kind of market reforms are needed, I request you to go through the report of the National Commission on Farmers. It is available on the website of the Krishi Bhavan, the Ministry of Agriculture. The National Commission on Farmers, we have recommended an Indian single market. You all know you produce a lot of onion. The Pune, Nasik area produces a lot of onion. But mostly, onion prices are very high, sometimes very low, very high. It's called a political crop, it's called in Delhi. It makes and unmakes chief ministers. The prices go up or prices go down. Finally, the farmer doesn't get anything. The problem is all these marketing arrangements. So whatever contribution you can make to make a small farmer-centric farming, we have recommended an Indian single market. All the barriers from state to state, if you go on a state boundary, you'll find trucks are standing there for a very long time. And how to ensure an Indian single market, you'll have to. Now, finally, I started by saying that Punjab Rao Deshmukh was keen on the technological upgrading of small farms. That is why the atoms on the farm, I requested you to take up molecules on the farm. Technological upgrading of small-scale agriculture is very essential to attract many of you here who have taken your degrees. I don't think you have got any intention to go to farming, most of you. You would like to get an organized job in the organized sector, whether the banks or companies, anywhere. You are not going to be like your parents, working hard to see there is no rain, there is one. But on the other hand, we require new technologies. Particularly, I would like you to take interest in both agricultural machinery, small-scale machinery. With the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Program, there are two problems our farmers are facing. One is the wild animals farmers problem. Those are important problems. In Maharashtra, the number of Gadchiroli, those areas you'll find, the wild animals cause a lot of problem. The other is the lack of labor at the right time. The lack of labor at the time of sowing, harvesting. That is why mechanization has become very important. Agricultural machinery, and that must be gender specific. For woman friendly agricultural machinery must be developed. This is a future. This is an area. Agricultural machinery is an area where there is a lot of opportunity in the coming years. Different kinds of machinery suited for the small farms is exceedingly important. The other area of technology is information technology, IT technology. I know in this hall there is probably nobody without a cell phone. All of you have got a mobile phone. You have switched it off. You have switched it off just now. As soon as you go out, you will put it on and you will talk to it. Mobile phone, iPad and so on have completely revolutionized communication technology. But that benefit should go to the farmer. Let me give you a simple example. The fishermen go, Maharashtra has a long coast and many of them are small fishermen, small boats. After the tsunami of 2004, the fishermen got very annoyed, very afraid of the sea. Suddenly tsunami came, very big land. Today, thanks to our Ministry of Earth Sciences, an organization called INCOIS in Hyderabad, you can provide small fishermen, before they get into the sea, information on wave heights at different distances from the ocean. You can also tell them where the fish are. There are a large number of opportunities today to modernize our fisheries, agriculture, animal husbandry and so on. The monsoon and the market are the two very important friends or enemies of the farmer. They can be, but we have to make them friends, the monsoon and the market. In other words, how do you do the monsoon management? This is my last point. Those of you who are going to continue to work in agriculture, whether it is banks or not, the time has come for you to take up seriously technological upgrading of the skills of our rural people. Share with them the new technology. For example, if you come to our foundation, you will find when I take you to the villages, you meet a woman there and ask, what are you? She will say, I'm a plant doctor. Another one will say, an academician of the National Virtual Academy. Another one will say, I'm a climate risk manager. The other one will say, I'm a community hunger fighter. You want to give prestige to our people, not that consider them as fools. And you are the only one who is intelligent. They have their own intelligence. We have to upgrade their knowledge. And we need now a strong whole series of, particularly among Mahila Kisans, very important to build their self-esteem. That's what is lacking today in the villages. But when the lady says, I am an academician of the National Virtual Academy, I am a plant doctor, I am a hunger fighter, I am a climate risk manager, then you have given them some status in society. Their own confidence in themselves goes up. So, ladies and gentlemen, there are a large number of opportunities for you. India is a land of opportunity. We don't recognize it, but opportunities will come. If I go on telling you about what all can be done with IT in agriculture, with BT in agriculture, with nuclear technologies in agriculture, and new agricultural engineering and implements in agriculture. I think our president is going to inaugurate in another few days at Nagpur, at the Central Cotton Research Institute, a big exhibition of new developments in agriculture. These are exciting days. Be proud of the fact that you belong to a nation which has given legal right to access to food. No other country has done. We have the largest social protection measure in the world with homegrown food, not with imported food. No more ship-to-mouth existence. If you have been working in the time I worked, people like Paul Ehrlich wrote books, Population Bomb. They said for Indians, there is no other way. except to die out of starvation, unless thermonuclear bomb kills them first. So we have graduated from those days. It is largely because synergy between technology and public policy. But technology can produce technologies, can your science and technology can produce technologies which are farmer friendly, but only public policy can ensure the economics of farming, the economic soundness, the input output pricing, family purchasing, and so on. So wish you all the best. Congratulations those who have taken so many degrees and medals, and all the best to you. Jai Hind, Jai Maharashtra.
या समारंभाचे प्रमुख अतिथी सन्माननीय डॉक्टर यशवंत थोरात भाषण करतील.
रिस्पेक्टेड व्हाइस चांसलर डॉक्टर स्वामीनाथन, द डॉयन ऑफ इंडियन एग्रीकल्चर, मेंबर्स ऑफ द एग्जीक्यूटिव एंड एकेडमिक काउंसिल्स, टीचर्स, गेस्ट्स, एलुमनाई हू हैव जस्ट टेकन देयर डिग्रीज, members of the press, ladies and gentlemen. It is both a pleasure and a privilege to have been invited to deliver the address at the 28th convocation ceremony of this university. First, my salutations to Dr. Panjabrao Deshmukh, a distinguished son of India, a distinguished son of Maharashtra, and a distinguished son of Vidarbha. You all know that Dr. Deshmukh was a member of the Constituent Assembly which gave